We saw some reaction yesterday from Columbus, from head coach Ryan Day, the Ohio State football team, again, advocating for his players and saying they want to play. We do have the athletic director at Ohio State now, Gene Smith, who is on with us. Gene, welcome. Thank you for taking the time to join us. It was obvious there was a strong movement within your team. You know, Justin Fields, maybe among the two most prominent players in college football heading into this year, along with Trevor Lawrence, making it very clear that he wanted to play. You had your head football coach saying the same thing. What is Ohio State's stance on the decision that was made today?
Well, obviously, we would have preferred to play. We were very aligned in our position that we felt that we could make it happen, but we knew that the possibility to postpone or cancel was a real possibility. Happened a little earlier than we would have liked, but the medical experts who provide us great advice helped us understand that we needed to do what we needed to do today. The health and safety of our student athletes are first and foremost. We're disappointed. We really are. We felt that we have put in place outstanding protocols here, as our student athletes shared. So we felt that it was a possibility. So wish we could have had a little bit more time to evaluate, but we certainly understand that this was the time that we had to pull the plug.
So, Gene, I just want to understand your statement off the top there where you say you would have preferred to play. I mean, I know you'd rather play football than not play football, but you're saying even given the information that you had, that Ohio State would have voted to continue at this point and not to shut everything down?
No, we stand with the league. We understand that the medical advice that we received, we understand that. We were getting ready to put on pads, and that was a point. That was a moment. Where, you know, the science began to become real. And we supported the fact that we needed to have to make a pause. So we would have preferred to play like everybody else with the passion that our student athletes have. But at the end of the day, the medical advice and the science overruled where we were today.
Can you give me any sense, and can you give people a sense who are trying to understand this and kind of come to grips with the decision, what that medical advice was? I mean, other than kind of a broad, hey, we don't necessarily think this is safe. Was there something that resonated with you or with the other ADs or the presidents where you just said, man, we just can't continue down this path?
Well, the contact tracing is one issue. Obviously, when you move into pads and the full contact, the contact tracing is an issue. And then the long-term effects. We just don't know. This is a virus that we don't have data on, historical data. So the long-term, short-term and long-term effects that it has on a person is concerning. We felt that it was important to respect that and make sure that we embrace the spring concept. I know there's a lot of challenges around that. There's a lot of issues around that. But as I told our team today, you know, I'm going to wake up tomorrow with a new vigor, a new passion to try and think out of the box, to think about the spring, to give them an opportunity to compete and play the game they love. So they have their scholarship. They have the ability to get their education. They have access to our facilities and services. So I'm going to try my best to figure out how can we help this possibly be done in the spring.
You know, Gene, you mentioned the contact tracing. And one of the things I've heard from a lot of people is, well, explain to me why it's safe for students to come back to campus. And a lot of these schools, they are coming back to campus, but it's not safe for the football players to play football. And it seems on the face fairly obvious to me. But I mean, again, we're talking about a full contact sport versus people socially distancing, and if they do go to class, wearing masks while they do it. I mean, you talked about that contact tracing, and what you're saying is this is a contact sport, a collision sport. People are constantly coming in contact with one another, and there was just no way to separate that out. Am I understanding you right when you talk about the contact tracing in that way?
Yeah, each game is different, as you well know. It could be anywhere from 70 plays a game to 90 plays a game, in some places 100 snaps a game. Just depends. But you have contact constantly. Now, the effort to try and create a clean field through testing and things of that nature, a real possibility. But the reality is the game is not like sitting in a classroom. It's not like walking across campus. It's not like wearing masks while you're in a lab. It's full contact. So while I understand the position that our medical people had around that, and I respect them, I know that people would have that question and draw that parallel. But it is different. You have practices, multiple practices, where there's constant contact. So I understand it, and I want to make sure that we not put our kids in harm's way when we ultimately have experts providing us outstanding advice along the way.
I asked this of Commissioner Warren. I'm interested in your take as well, just given the juxtaposition of the 6 days from the schedule release to the cancellation. What happened in that time period? Was there one specific straw that broke the camel's back, or was it just an accumulation?
Yeah, I think it's accumulation more than anything. You know, when you look at the aggregate of issues, you know, as ADs, we were just planning. You know, we had our head down. We're managers. We're rolling. We're planning. And then there's parallel things happening. You know, kids are practicing. Things are going on. And information is coming to you. And so information began to come. And we started to evaluate that. And we ended up where we ended up.
What was the conversation that you referenced earlier with your team? What was that conversation like?
Well, you know, we were really, really sad and disappointed we couldn't provide them the opportunity. And that's what I told them. You know, I told them I failed them. You know, I feel I did because we weren't able to create the ultimate protocols for the game itself where we could feel comfortable playing it. And I shared with them, I feel like I felt them, and I apologized to them and told them that, I'm going to wake up tomorrow with a passion to see if we can figure out a way for them to compete in the spring and play the game they love. Shared with them that if they still have so many things to be thankful for. We're going to continue to provide them their services relative to medical attention and strength and conditioning if they want to take advantage of those and they get a chance to get their education on scholarship. So they have a lot of things to be thankful for. So spend the night to go through your depression, but wake up tomorrow with a new passion and a new focus on how you're going to attack the day and attack the future, because that's life. That's what you have to do. And so this is a disappointing at this point in time. But our president was phenomenal. Christina Johnson, she challenged everything to try and look at whether a delay was the right thing to do or whether the cancellation and postponement was the right thing to do. She challenged. And I couldn't be more proud of her leadership. We would have ultimately preferred to go to September 26 or October 1st with the start of the season. But the science came to us so fast. And so we just had to move.
You know, I smiled when you said to deal with your depression overnight because I feel like I'm going to be doing the same thing here tonight. You know, it's devastating for all of us who love this sport and who love the competition of college football and the pageantry and everything that goes along with it. What can you tell us about winter sports, about basketball, about some of the other sports that people love and are passionate about? What will you need to see, Gene, in order to be able to compete in those seasons?
Well, you know, I had to speak with our women's soccer team, our men's soccer team, our women's volleyball team, field hockey team, and of course our football team. And so that was extremely challenging. And we know that the winter sports, those sports that are crossover sports, like men's and women's ice hockey and swimming and those sports that actually start competing in October and November, we have to have conversations about. And basketball the same way. I'm hopeful that the numbers, the pandemic numbers, subside and go down. I know in our state and in our county and in June, based upon what our governor had done, the numbers were going down, and then now they've gone back up, and now they're starting to go back down. So I'm hopeful as we get into the winter time frame, the numbers go down. Hopefully, tests emerge that are a lot better, and we can move faster. So I'm hopeful that we'll have a different view, a different handle on the pandemic as we move into the late October and November timeframe. So those decisions remain to be made, and I'm hopeful we can figure out a way to allow those sports to kick off.
Ohio State Athletic Director Gene Smith. Gene, thanks a lot for your time on what I know is a difficult day for everyone associated with Big Ten athletics. Really appreciate your time.
Well, thank you. I know all of our fans are disappointed, and I'm sorry. But our health and safety of our kids are so important. And I hope that you would, for every college campus and every student athlete, you continue to embrace them and support them. And whatever model we come up with for the spring, I would ask that you be patient with us and ultimately embrace that as well. So thank you. Appreciate the opportunity.
Okay. Thanks, Gene.